Hello and welcome. My name is Leo Appleyard. I'm a jazz guitarist and composer and have lived in Birmingham, Britain's second city, for the last 4 years now. Having been raised in South London, my early experiences of jazz have been at some of the capital's most iconic venues, including the Bull's Head in Barnes and the 606 Club in Chelsea. And I've been lucky enough to witness world-class jazz on my doorstep from a very young age. 5 years ago now, I decided to take the plunge and relocate to Birmingham to study jazz at the Conservatoire of Music and to explore the vibrant scene of an undiscovered city. In this programme, I hope to show you a perhaps unfamiliar yet flourishing jazz community in a city that's rich jazz heritage goes as far back as the 1950s and beyond, and also showcase an emerging young generation of musicians who are becoming leading lights in UK jazz. Over the next hour, I will be speaking to artists who are responsible for some of the most exciting new sounds coming out of Birmingham, including MOBO award-winning saxophonist and MC Soweto Kinch, free jazz legend Paul Dunmall, and celebrated promoter Tony Dudley Evans. This is New Jazz in Birmingham, the second city scene. In order to fully understand and explore the vast history of jazz in Birmingham, I needed to talk to someone who has lived through it all, and there is no better person than award-winning jazz promoter Tony Dudley Evans. Born and bred in Birmingham, Tony has chaired the Birmingham Jazz Organisation since 1985 and is responsible for the amazingly diverse and frequent jazz concerts happening in and around the city. Well known for programming the renowned Cheltenham International Jazz Festival, I caught up with Tony just as his organisation, Birmingham Jazz, was rebranding with help from a strong collaboration with Birmingham's City of Birmingham Symphony Orchestra Centre, known locally as the CBSO. Hi Tony, well thanks for joining me on the show.
That's fine.
My first question to you, what are your first memories and encounters of live jazz in Birmingham?
Well, my first experience of jazz was really rather amazing because it was the Humphrey Littleton Band at Birmingham Town Hall. It was a time when he was changing from a straightforward New Orleans style, which was quite popular at the time, this was in the 1950s, he was changing from that style to a more sort of swing style, small group Ellington. And he'd added a couple of saxophones to the lineup. And this met with a very angry reaction from the audience who were expecting the New Orleans style. So there were quite angry protests. And I always remember there was a banner that said, "Go home, dirty bebopper." So that was an amazing experience. I then went to a number of other concerts at the Town Hall. I particularly remember seeing Jack Teagarden and Earl Hines. But I think my strongest memory of my early jazz listening in Birmingham was seeing Dexter Gordon play just in an upstairs room in a pub in, it was in Sparkbrook. It was with Ronnie Scott, and they were running occasional events in Birmingham on the back of sort of events at the club in London. But it was just amazing to see Dexter Gordon at the height of his powers. Sure. And then another strong memory was seeing the John Coltrane Quartet with Eric Dolphy. That was at the Birmingham Hippodrome.
Thank you. That was the John Coltrane Quintet live at the Birdland with My Favourite Things. So, Tony, you've held the chair of the Birmingham Jazz Organisation since 1985. What were your original aims when you took on this position?
I joined the committee of Birmingham Jazz, and after a few years, they asked me to be chair. Really, at first, it was just really carrying on what was quite a successful programme. But I saw the opportunity to really broaden that programme. When I took over, it was running weekly jazz, well, not weekly jazz, regular jazz, I should say, at the Strathallan Hotel in the room there. And that mostly worked with more mainstream bands. I saw the opportunity to expand the programme, so keeping on with the sort of more straight-ahead jazz, but expanding into other more adventurous areas as well. And that was an aim which kind of wasn't there really at the beginning, but gradually became obvious as something I could take the society towards.
Sure. So how do you think the scene in Birmingham has changed since you started in 1985 to the present day?
Well, I think it's broadened quite considerably. I actually think this is a very good time for jazz because there's so much happening. I mean, you may not get the publicity and the attention in the press or on the television, to a certain extent it does on the radio. But there's so much happening. I mean, you've got your straight-ahead jazz, but you've got your sort of freer jazz. You've got interesting things happening in Europe. I think the New York scene, the Chicago scene, there are lots of interesting things happening. So I think the change is that an audience has developed for a range of jazz and a variety of jazz, which wasn't really there at the beginning. And undoubtedly, the start of the jazz course at the Conservatoire has had a big effect on the scene.
This is an extract of an original composition from student Chris Young with his new quartet octet. The track is entitled Remembrance. So Birmingham was once home to the only franchise of the world-famous Ronnie Scott's Jazz Club. What was its impact on the jazz scene, and why do you think it ultimately failed? Were the audiences of Birmingham simply not ready for the club?
Yes, I think it's a very sad story, really, the Ronnie Scott's, and I could talk at great length. When it first started, they programmed what was happening in London,
okay,
including the support acts. And I think that was a mistake. And they often programmed them for, you know, they do 1 week in London and then 2 weeks in Birmingham. And that was really stretching the audience. I think the way that, you see, I mean, it's changed. Ronnie Scott's in London has changed quite a bit because they used to have people on for at least a week and often for 2 weeks. Mm. Now they changed the pattern so they have bands on often just for two nights or three nights, occasionally only for one night. And I think that's been, that's increased the audience in London. And if they tried that kind of formula in Birmingham, I think it would have been more successful. So they started off and they had these bands for a week or 2 weeks. And some of the audiences that were going there were going because, oh, we're going to Ronnie Scott's, sort of a fashionable place to go rather than to listen to the music.
Sure. How do you feel the Birmingham scene and perhaps the music has changed with the increasing number of students coming to this city to study at the conservatoire?
Yeah. Well, I think it has had a very positive effect on the jazz scene in two ways. One, in terms of our programme, the students have usually they're interested in particular kinds of bands, often the more adventurous bands and also the sort of big names. And so it's enabled us to put on certain things, knowing that, you know, 30 or 40 students will come.
So the Birmingham Jazz Organisation has recently evolved and collaborated with the Symphony Hall to form a new organisation called Jazz Lines.
Yes.
Could you tell me a bit more about that?
Yes, this comes about as a result of recommendation from the Arts Council. We've had quite reasonable funding from the Arts Council. But in a situation where the grants were being cut by the government, we were strongly advised to join forces with Symphony Hall. It means that I will carry on what has been the Birmingham Jazz programme within Symphony Hall. So we will carry on with the programme at CBSO Centre, at Mac, at Hare and Hounds, etc. Under a new name, which is Jazz Lines.
The Lottie Hodgson Sextet with Lottie's version of the famous standard Lullaby of Birdland. Originally from Scarborough, vocalist Lottie Hodgson has frequently performed her original compositions and skillfully arranged standards at venues in and around the city. At just 20 years old, Lottie has put together a very mature-sounding sextet, and I caught up with her to discuss her roots and her approach to composition and improvisation.
I started to sing jazz at the age of 16. I just picked a CD from HMV, just randomly, and found that I really loved it. It was Sarah Vaughan. And then from Sarah Vaughan, I started to listen to Chet Baker and Ella Fitzgerald. I think the reason why I picked them is because I hadn't heard singing like it before, and I was really interested in all the scatting they were doing. I'd never heard anything like it before, really.
The track we just heard was your take on the classic jazz standard Lullaby of Birdland, and you've composed a new melody over the existing chord changes. How did you come up with this new line?
Well, I've always loved the standard and improvising over the chord changes. So I wanted to try and make it a bit more of my own, really. So I thought I'd make it, try and do it a bit more modern approach to fit into the vibe of my sextet.
Okay.
I've also been listening to a lot of Lenny Tristano. So this inspired me a lot to write the line.
So as a jazz vocalist, do you feel that Birmingham has presented you with lots of experiences and opportunities?
Yeah, I do. I've been very privileged to be taught by Percy Persclove and Jean Toussaint, and also gigging around Birmingham, these experiences which I never thought I would be able to do.
Sure. So are you involved in any other projects?
Yeah, well, I've got a trio, which is Hamish Livingstone on the bass and Christopher Young on alto saxophone. This is more standards, which we do. And because it's chordless and drumless, it's quite a challenge for me, which is great.
Sure, okay. So pushing your vocal limits without having the comfort blanket of a harmony instrument.
Yeah, really, challenging my improvisation, really.
Well, Lottie, my last question for you. What are your future plans for creating music in Birmingham?
Well, I'm going to carry on writing for my sextet, do some arrangements, and hopefully we'll get some more gigs and maybe even tour if we can.
Thanks, Lottie. New York saxophonist and composer Ben Bryden is a rising star in the improvised music world, and his work is recognised in Europe and the US. A graduate of the world-renowned Master of Jazz programme at Manhattan School of Music, and also Birmingham Conservatoire, Ben was an integral part of the Birmingham jazz scene. His new project, Bright Noise, is the collaborative project of two tenor players, Ben himself and Belgian Stephen Delannoy. Leading lights of the genre in their respective nations, they are part of a growing scene characterized by alternative rock influences and odd time signatures. This track is entitled Happy Hour. My next guest is a legend of free jazz music and has played with numerous iconic musicians, including Alice Coltrane. Saxophonist and multi-instrumentalist Paul Dunmall is based musically and geographically in the Second City, and I wanted to know why. Your music is very spiritual, and Birmingham's perhaps not recognised as a spiritual centre. How have you found that your music has worked with spirituality in the city?
The spiritual thing, it's within you. It doesn't matter where you are. You know, you can be on the moon or where it's you. All that discovery are within yourself. It doesn't matter where you live. The external surroundings, okay, it's nice to be in somewhere peaceful, but spiritual person is a spiritual person, whether he's, you know, in New York or wherever.
So you've played with a lot of musicians in Birmingham. Have you felt a connection with the musicians from Birmingham over perhaps other areas of the country, or were you just happy to play with people who are around?
What I've found in Birmingham in the last, say, 10 years is the young people seem to really... There's a lot of really good players. I don't know whether that's the Birmingham Conservatoire. It probably is. It's attractive people. But the standard is very high, and I think it's got a buzz to it, Birmingham, for me. There's a good scene up north in Leeds and what have you, and London, it doesn't seem so much for London. It probably is going on, but Birmingham to me has got a real buzz and it's fantastic, I must say.
Okay, and as you're recognised and perhaps put in this label as a free jazz musician, I hope I'm okay in perhaps saying that. I know sure. The lines are a bit blurred. But how do you interpret the free jazz label, and what does that mean to you as a player?
Well, labels are labels, but what it means to me, because I've played all different musics, but I'm free to play however I feel and to respond to whatever sounds I hear and to respond, in a deep way, to who I'm playing with. But I know I used to play standards and all that. I've done that, but I found the free thing much more... I could go deeper within myself doing that. It may not be for everyone, but for me, that's how it came for me, you know.
Okay, sure. And you say you're free from the processes of harmony and rhythm, but
yeah.
Do you go through some processes in your mind when you start, you know, free piece?
Or is it completely... not at all. The idea is to get rid of that. The idea, that was the whole point. In fact, the less I think about it, the better. I mean, what's so exciting for me about it is we walk on stage. Let's say me and you are doing a duet, okay? Mm. Free duet. I walk on stage. I have no idea if it's going to be loud, fast, quiet. I don't know who's going to start. So you have to really tune in, and then you have to surrender to the music. The music, if you can surrender to music, it'll take care of you, you know, and it will give you the right things to do. But when you start using your conscious mind, I think I'll do this, or I think I'll play that, I'll play loud now. It will not have it. Music doesn't respond to that. And it will sound false and it won't work. You've got to actually surrender to the sound of the music and it will take care of you.
I was going to say, because as an improviser, I'm concentrating at the moment and trying to, you know, outline changes, and it's very hard to actually just pick up the instrument and play something that I don't have an idea about what it is, or, you know, it's hard to escape the kind of rules that we're all used to. Yeah. So when you were first playing free jazz, I mean, how did you approach it?
Well, the thing is, for me, I was doing both. I was playing in bands, playing straight, and playing in free situations. So I'm doing the two. I'm studying, you know, playing, I'm getting my, I don't know what you'd call it, jazz licks, or that's a terrible term, but working on that. Getting that right, trying to get everything good, you know, so my playing's good, so my notes and intonation, everything is working well. And then in the free thing, making it so that that they come together, the free and the standard playing, you know.
And so what upcoming projects do you have, perhaps based around in Birmingham or in
the
future?
Well, I'm 60 next year, and I want to get a band of Birmingham players. I've already got some in mind, but I've got to try and get a bit of funding to make it work, which I think is going to happen. And I am playing with some young Birmingham players and have been doing for quite a few years now. So I want to do that. I want to do a project with all Birmingham people, you know.
cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness.
That was Cabal Trio with a sample from their latest CD. Check them out online to get your free copy.
More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness.
Still only in his mid-20s, Birmingham-based pianist and composer David Austin Gray is proving to be one of the city's most in-demand jazz musicians. Having been taught and mentored by numerous esteemed educators, including Liam Noble, Hans Koller, and Mike Williams, David has just released an album of original material and one arranged standard entitled The Dark Red Room, featuring special guest Soweto Kinch on alto saxophone, alongside the regular band, comprising of Sam Worcester on trumpet, Nick Jurd on double bass, and James Bashford on drums. The project is heavily inspired by film, photography, and cinema, and draws influence from hip-hop, rock, and modern classical music, while set firmly in the contemporary jazz idiom. So what are your first memories or encounters of live jazz in Birmingham?
As a fan of music and a fan of jazz, one of the first things that I can remember is probably going to a live concert at Symphony Hall in Birmingham with my dad. We went to see Hugh Masekela, who's a South African jazz trumpeter. And yeah, that was just, I really enjoyed being in that venue. It's like quite a kind of a grand venue, basically.
Yeah, it's quite epic, isn't
it? Yeah, and the sound was just like amazing, you know, and to sort of be sort of in his presence, like while he was playing and stuff, and really appreciate and enjoy the type of music that he was bringing to Birmingham, basically, and bringing to the UK. That was a really good experience for me.
And so did you have any experiences of sort of smaller band jazz at all in Birmingham at that age?
I think maybe like a bit later on, I remember sort of wanting to try and get into the jazz scene and starting to really appreciate jazz music. So I wanted to go and check out live gigs, and probably one of the first places that I went to was what is now the Yardbird Jazz Club. But I think at that time it was the Bread and Roses pub. And I remember they had like jam sessions and things in there. And yeah, I remember going along, and I think it was sort of seeing people like Soweto Kinch up on stage, and other people sort of prominent in the Birmingham scene at that time, especially from the Cobweb Collective, which is a jazz collective made up of Birmingham-based musicians, and sort of being introduced to people like Tom Chapman, who's a drummer and percussionist, and Aaron Diaz, who's a trumpeter, and just really kind of going on to jam sessions, basically, and being able to get up on stage and you know, play through tunes and with people. I think that was just that helped me to get into the scene and really appreciate what people were doing.
Your music has a lot of influences. You've quoted rock music and neoclassical music and, of course, modern jazz. So who are the influences outside of the jazz world?
Apart from jazz, like just straight ahead and contemporary jazz itself, like one of the main things that I'm really sort of a massive fan of is hip hop. So that's definitely been a big influence in the writing style. It's not to suggest that the music that I'm writing or playing is hip hop music. I mean, I have been fortunate to be able to work with people like YG, who's a New York based MC, and Illspoken as well, as another New York based MC. They're both great, very talented artists, and so that's been a pleasure to work to try and bring a bit of crossover into the music.
It's just a matter of time before development begins, but who am I? Just a descendant of the music created in picturesque street corners. words formed from the dark rooms developed from heat spawners let loose on the click, clack, click, 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 click to develop the cat's eye. If streets are the moors, then the meaning of course. I'm lost in the dark, cold to the gone, endorsed by the bars that are locking it all. Ironic, the bars are the thoughts that key to the free style people can breathe. Developing the envelope, sailing them in. Walls in the ceiling, a calling again. Dark rooms, positive, slim. Work what I got, develop what I can. Set tones for the digital event. Scene to the scene. Overexposed, close other doors. Sensitive to light, but the darkness is flawed. Photoshop in the lore. Watering down, dropping the walls. Distorted on course. Big screen, I picture it all. Still, pick a moment, it's over. Holding the focus, shot range. 35mm flash card.
Your new CD, The Dark Red Room, is clearly heavily influenced by photography and cinema. Where did the inspiration come from?
Well, those two things that you mentioned there are two of my big passions. Photography, just the idea of capturing a moment. I'm interested myself in trying to improve my skill at that, just as a hobby and as an amateur, but I've got a great kind of fondness for photography and for an admiration for people that can kind of convey an emotion through an image, basically. And the same applies to film. People that can kind of tell a story or capture a scene, and the attention to detail which is involved in the cinematography and the editing process, and that's something that I'm really a fan of, and I'd like to try and bring to music, that kind of same attention to detail as well.
So how heavily has the city scene influenced your compositions?
I think it has, to some extent. I'm a big fan of travel as well. I like to travel when I can. But obviously, Birmingham's my home. It's where I was born. It's obviously where I live now. So it's definitely had an influence on what I'm doing musically, whether it's like a conscious thing. I mean, sometimes it is, but a lot of the time it's just a subconscious kind of acceptance and appreciation of the environment that I'm in, and seeing the beauty in seemingly kind of fairly grey landscape at times,
sure.
But also kind of accepting like the circumstances and the environment that you're in, and trying to using those emotions and playing on that to try and bring something out in the music. And obviously I want to represent Birmingham at the same time as well, being from Birmingham myself.
Your band, Greyish Quartet, has a new CD out, The Dark Red Room, which we've just talked about, which is available on Amazon and iTunes. Tell us a little bit about the band.
Well, other than myself, the band consists of Sam Worcester, who's a trumpet player, Jim Bashford on drum kit, and Nick Jerd on double bass.
And they're all Birmingham-based musicians.
That's right, yeah.
All right, your CD also features special guest Soweto Kinch and various other artists.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a bit more about who else is involved in the project?
Yeah, well, there's a vocal track featuring Jason McDougall, who's a good friend of mine and a great singer. Again, another Birmingham-based artist. So he features on a ballad that we do on the album. And there's also two New York-based artists, Ill-Spoken and YG, who are both MCs from Brooklyn, New York. So, yeah, it's great to have them on board, and really, really humbled and happy to be able to work with such a variety of different people on the project.
This is David Gray with his Greyish Quartet, and the track is called Why So Negative?
Thank you.
The final musician on my interviewee list is arguably one of the most important figures in UK contemporary jazz, and has risen to fame winning a MOBO award and multiple BBC Jazz Awards. Saxophonist and Birmingham resident Soweto Kinch has a long-standing association with the city and its music scene. Raised and educated in the heart of the Second City, Soweto discovered his passion for jazz in his early teens after a chance meeting with the legendary American jazz trumpeter and celebrity in his own right, Wynton Marsalis. By 2001, the Soweto Kinch Trio was firmly established, with performances at Birmingham's Ronnie Scott's Jazz Club, supporting influential British saxophonist Courtney Pine. Since then, Soweto's affiliation with Birmingham has not dwindled, and in fact the city has become an ongoing theme in his music, highlighted by the 2006 release, A Life in the Day of B19, Tales of the Tower Block, which provides a gritty insight into Soweto's immediate surroundings. In 2008, Soweto launched a project that exposed the vast diversity and musical talent that Birmingham has to offer, organising and hosting his very own festival, The Flyover Show. Located under a motorway flyover in Hockley, northwest of the city centre. I caught up with Soweto in a local cafe in the middle of Birmingham's busy jewellery quarter. My first question for you really is, what are your first memories and encounters of live jazz in Birmingham when you were growing up?
Some of my first encounters were going along to the Bear to see Andy Hamilton play. He played every kind of Monday night.
And the Blue Notes.
That's right, and the Blue Notes. And that encounter was really important, not just because of seeing Andy himself, but also as a conduit for other players who are on the scene. Steve Ajayo, I saw him there. Also Andy Gale, that was the first time I met him there. And it's always given me a sense of how rich the tendrils of, you know, jazz within the city emanate from one or two people.
Sure, okay. And so you originally started playing clarinet. Seeing these musicians that you've just described, did that influence you to pick up the saxophone, although you played piano a bit
as
well?
I'd actually started playing the saxophone before I'd encountered them.
Okay.
But one of the first people I met was an alto saxophonist called Alvin, who's still playing on the scene. And, you know, gave me a few lessons. There was a guy called Bill who I went to go buy my saxophone with as well. But in terms of getting the flame lit, by people who I thought, right, I'd like to be like them when I go. Personally, Steve Ajayo was the first person like that I met in Birmingham.
Okay, and you had a chance meeting with Wynton Marsalis, I hear.
That's right.
Can you tell me a little bit about that and how it...
He was playing at the Symphony Hall. I was 13 years old then.
Okay.
And sitting in the audience, and by then, kind of alive to the ideas of jazz, but still not very knowledgeable. And myself and a young drummer called Howard Smith, who's also a rapper like myself, Rex.
Sure.
We were in a young crew at 13. We snuck backstage.
Oh,
and
wow.
Wessel Anderson like welcomed us. He's like, oh, don't worry, come in, come meet Wynton. I remember standing before him and singing St. Thomas because I didn't have my horn on me.
Right.
My friend was playing a pair of knives on the table, took us to the piano and just, you know, basically infused us about playing the music for about half an hour to 45 minutes, when most jazz musicians are probably off looking for some tail or, you know.
Yeah, so he really took you in and gave you experience. That's amazing.
Absolutely.
So how has the Birmingham jazz scene changed since you first knew it, since you were growing up, to the present day?
It's been a huge, you know, momentous 15 years, I think, from going to the Ronnie Scott's that was up here, and the Fiddle and Bone, and a whole, you know, wealth of live music venues. It's quite a dark period when everything got shut down. And
I was going to say, Ronnie Scott's closed, didn't it? Could you tell me a little bit about that and your experiences playing there, perhaps?
Well, I had one gig there myself. I went as a punter maybe 7 or 8 times, and I don't know if they ever quite got the balance of kind of jazz aficionados and just the regular public and the kind of more yuppie market.
There. Right, okay.
And even the London club struggles to get that balance right at certain times. But I guess the death nail was when the Rocket Club bought them out and it became a strip club. And the Fiddle and Bone closed down because of local residents in the luxury apartments complaining about noise.
Right.
You know, okay. It was around that time that I started doing the Live Box. And that was my own kind of initiative, my idea to play, to cut my teeth really, find an ensemble, and to showcase a night which would involve poetry, a jam session in a more conventional sense. And that, as soon as I came out of university, really gave me a chance to meet all of the local jazz musicians and national ones. There was a point Winton came down to that jam session at, at the Live Box. That was when I'd met him, you know, so some 9 or 10 years later, he turns up with Wes Anderson and a whole bunch of great musicians from the region. Carl Hemingsley was on drums. That was a great night. Andy Gale was there. It was really special.
So that's been running for about eight or nine years
more,
now?
More than that now. 11 years.
Oh, wow.
For 11 years.
Brilliant.
And still happening.
Still happening.
Still happening in the figurative and literal sense.
Great, man. So you've been running a mini festival called the Flyover Show since 2008, I believe. What were your original aims for the show, and what impact do you think it's had on the younger generation with regards to fusing hip hop and other genres of music with jazz in the city?
It's hard to really quantify the impact because I still get people saying, "Oh, remember the first year you did this workshop with me, and now I'm doing my own group." And but for me, my original intentions were looking around in that area, in the area that I live, and realizing most young people are probably drawn to the more American-esque bling aspects of hip-hop.
Okay.
And they're completely unaware that there's this wealth of hip-hop talent right on their doorstep.
Yeah,
and this
sure.
wealth of jazz talent. In the very tower block that I live in, there's Andy Gale inhabits it. It's the same space. He's a great jazz musician in the region. Richie Garrison was a couple of blocks away. And there's all these kind of, you know, this, this wealth of a jazz community, and we're not known in our community. And also there's this thing of generations not, not finding a place to link up.
Okay.
You know, I was starting to feel like certainly the generation above me were alienated from all the creative things that were happening. And the idea of violence. The only times that my area in particular gets on the news is because of a race riot or gun crime,
a
litigious space. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I felt it was really important to reclaim the space, to make it a public event and to make it free so that people would be able to make up their own mind as to whether things such as poetry or jazz or anything left field is too highbrow for them or whether they accept it. You know, and it was a big challenge, I think, not just to present the show for the community, but also to give the correct impression that this isn't just an inverted commas community event.
Yeah.
It's supposed to turn the idea of what high art is on its head. To say that jazz is coming out of these areas, underground hip-hop, breakdance, a whole system of aesthetics is coming out of these areas, and we need to showcase it.
And so now that it's been running for a few years very successfully, how do you feel that's actually been implemented into the community, if you will? So how, what are the effects of the festival? Have you seen a change in your area at all?
I have, actually. I've seen it go from something that seemed like a really kooky idea, because everybody from the local residents association to, you know, people outside the area thought, why are you doing it there underneath a motorway flyover? Isn't it going to be too loud? Isn't there going to be gun crime, all kinds of gang activity? And from the point of it starting off as an untried idea to now, as an accepted and also waited upon kind of event for a lot of people in the area.
Yeah.
I see a young dance crew last year came to me some 5 months before it, said, "Are you still doing the flyover show? We've got a routine we want to showcase." And they opened up the show this year. It's something that the local, not just the residents, but the businesses, the shops relish. They're like, "Oh, great, when is it happening?" Even taxi services, you know, so it is something that's embedded in the area.
And the location is perhaps the best thing about it. It's really symbolic of what you're trying to do rather than hosting it in a park or, you know, somewhere somewhere else. So you base yourself in Birmingham. When London has arguably the biggest sort of jazz scene, what keeps you here musically?
I think it is that sense of community, of being embedded in an area. It gives me my ideas, it gives me a sense of perspective. Going to London's great, and I feel like I enjoy all of its benefits without having to suffer its drawbacks, to be frank.
Sure, okay.
You know, all the band, most of my musicians are based in London. I'm touring internationally a fair bit, so Birmingham's just very much a base, a place for me to recharge. At this minute, as we're discussing, I'm in the lab, as it were, brewing up my new album and doing all the beats and hip-hop side of production at the minute. So.
Sure, I was going to ask you about your upcoming projects. I know you've also had a commission from the British Film Institute.
That's correct.
So can you tell me a little bit about that and how you're approaching these new projects?
Sure. Well, the Alfred Hitchcock project is very exciting. I've written a number of theatre scores before, but writing a score for The Ring, which is one of his early silent films, is a huge, you know, it's a gift and a challenge at once. I mean, the palette that I'm going to be using is quite broad. I think that's one of the reasons the BFI approached me, rather than just doing a crudely reconstructed version of a 1920s film score.
Yeah, sure. Know,
I think they want my emotional and visceral reaction to it as well as a film.
So what sort of instrumentation are you going to be using or utilising for this project?
Well, conventional jazz sextet, but with triggers as well and effects.
Okay.
And I think sections where we extemporise with the thing, as it's almost in a more of a live way.
Okay, great. Mm-hmm. And also you're currently recording your new album, which is out in September, hopefully.
That's correct.
So tell me a little bit about the theme behind that.
Yes, it's an epic. It's an exploration of the seven deadly sins in our modern culture, and really takes place through the journey of one MC who's attempting to get ready for a grand performance at the end of the day.
Okay.
And at every single juncture, as he's attempting to buy his microphone, attempting to get his material rehearsed, attempting to meet up with people, he's confronted by these overwhelming, powerful forces from another realm.
Wow, that sounds really, really good.
It gives me a lot of music to work with and a lot of thematic material, and I've written most of it.
It's and briefly, recording. The musicians on that record include...
Oh, well, a lot of the people I've been touring with, really, and getting a real synergy with. I'm really lucky to have been with Carl Rashid-Abel on bass. Graham Godfrey is a great drummer. And for most of this record, Shabaka Hutchings. Julian Joseph plays on a couple of tracks as a guest and just completely brought his energy and positive spirit to the project. And Jay Phelps as well as a guest.
Amazing, so an all-star cast.
Absolutely, but... one where it feels that there's synergy and it's a union for the right reasons. You know, I hate kind of super groups on jazz albums.
Yeah, sure.
This is definitely a meeting of kindred spirits.
Brilliant. Okay. So what are your thoughts on the future of jazz in Birmingham and attracting a wider audience? Obviously, you've run your flyover show, so that's definitely helped the music scene in the city.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, where do you see the future of jazz in this city?
I see it wherever the musicians wish to take it. There's so many... you know, shoots of great music happening in the city. Just look at David Gray's quartet, the Grayish Quartet, all the musicians that, you know, were part of the Yardbird jam sessions and are still playing, and people coming out of the conservatoire still, you sound great. That's the beautiful thing, a marvelous thing about the music, that to anticipate which way it will go will always fool you. You know, you'll always be surprised by a new pocket of invention just when you think everyone's playing the same.
This is the end of my journey through the extensive musical landscape that is the Birmingham jazz and improvised music scene. Along the way, I've met and spoken to musicians that interpret jazz in all manner of styles, from bebop to hip-hop, free jazz to contemporary jazz, all with brilliant integrity and veracity. As always, the music speaks for itself, but any jazz fans out there wanting to visit the city will be treated to an array of musical happenings and events unique to Birmingham. Thanks to my guests for being part of this project. This has been a Leo Appleyard production, co-produced and engineered by Owain Fleetwood Jenkins.